You mentioned the labor strike in 1994. You ended up having some time. So Dad says, "Hey, man, come hit the road with us." You became part of the team.
Right. It was the cool thing about it was we went on strike the middle of August, and they sent all the major league guys to minor league teams. Right. So I ended up going to rookie ball for like a week, and their season got over. So it was August 24th, something like that, 28th, and your dad and I were going to go hunting in South Carolina. So we were going to meet after the Michigan race. So I'll never forget this. That Michigan race was the race that Ernie got in that wreck.
Mm, yeah.
And Ernie was really going to die, right? So your dad flies in. It was 3 o'clock in the morning, and we were calling every half hour to see if Ernie had passed away. And we're sitting on this back porch. It was a beautiful night. I mean, a South Carolina night in August. It wasn't too hot. It was just beautiful. And we were sitting back there drinking a couple of beers. And your dad looked at me and he said, "Hey, you know, if this can happen to Ernie, this can happen to me." And I'm like, "What are you talking about?" He goes, Ernie's 30 points behind me. Ernie's got great equipment. He's a championship caliber driver. He's got a great team. If it can happen to him, it can happen to me." And I'm like, "Nah, that can't happen to you." Because, you know, he was bulletproof. He was 10 foot tall, right? You never thought that would happen to him.
Right.
Never.
Yep.
Right? So the next week, we ended up hunting, and we're having these, like, conversations and stuff, because it really affected him that Ernie was that hurt. So next week, the minor league season's all over. We got nothing to do. The 1st of September, he calls me. He goes, "What are you doing?" "I ain't doing nothing." He goes, "Come work on my race team. Help us win this 7th championship." I'm like, "Well, yeah, maybe that'll be cool, right?" He goes, "Yeah, you get to see 9 races. You get to see some tracks you probably never see again." He said, "Come help us." So I'm like, "Okay." Sure enough, the first race was Darlington, right? And I'll never forget, I was the rehydration engineer. People would ask, "What do you do?" "I'm a rehydration engineer. Keep walking," right? They didn't know. I just, like, gave them the water, right?
During the pit stops.
Yeah. So anyway, I didn't know what I was doing, and nobody told me anything, right?
Yeah.
So they give you this gallon of water, and you mix in this electrolyte solution. You can't give them too much. Give them 3 inches and because you don't want him peeing his pants during the race, he just will sip it, right? So I'm like, "Okay." So I'm standing there with this pole, and first pit stop, I'm nervous as hell, right? So he comes, so I'm here, like, inching this pole out. When I'm inching it, the water's going like this. I look at your dad, I look at this, he goes, "Stop, stop." So stop like this. He goes, "All right, so put a little stop like this." He goes, "Hey, tell Ned to only put 3 inches of water in that cup. It's going to splash on the radio and short it out." And I'm thinking to myself, "I only got 3 inches in there. Just give me a chance to get used to this, right?" So after that, I figured out real quick that you extend the pole, get it under the rear tire changer's butt, and when he jumps, you just swing that pole, boom, into that little hole right there, right? Well, I was a natural rehydration engineer from that point on. So it was really cool to be able to watch your dad work and his mindset. And like I said, it started there when he finished second. And, you know, I'm thinking, okay, this has got to be a joke, but it wasn't. He was serious about it. The next week, you're at North Wilkesboro, right? And that was the day that Jeff Bodine lapped the entire field. But the thing that I enjoyed about that was your dad was just busting ass, man. He was fighting. I think he ended like 4 or 5 laps down. But, I mean, he was running like he was leading, right? So the spotter came on and goes, "Richard, when there's an next caution, I need to tell you something." And Dale goes, "Tell him now." And he goes, "No, I'll wait for the caution." He goes, "I said tell him now." He goes, "Bobby Hamilton came up and said you're being too aggressive with him. If he catches up to you, he's putting you in the wall." Dale goes, "You tell Bobby Hamilton that if he wants, I will gladly meet him under the grandstands after the race, but don't be wrecking no damn race cars."
Yeah.
Right? And I'm like, "Oh, wow, this is my type of sport right here," right? And he never ended up catching up to him. But as the races went on, I would watch his competitiveness, and I would watch how he would never quit. Didn't matter what the situation was. Now, I'm starting to think, you know, I'm playing in a baseball game, and we're down 7 or 8, nothing going into the eighth inning. My mind starts to wander, well, like, okay, maybe we'll get him tomorrow, right? That never entered your dad's mind, yeah. Ever. He just, if he was 10 laps down with 11 to go, he was running just as hard as if he won. So I'm watching all this, right? And we get into Charlotte here, and it's the October race. I mean, I'll never forget this because this was one of the coolest lessons I think that I learned from your dad.
Yeah.
Was that I remember it was a gorgeous day. We pushed the Black 3 out onto pit road, and the crowd was going nuts, right? So get your dad ready. Get him in the car. At this point, he qualified 38th. Rusty Wallace was second behind him, 208 points behind him, right? So start the race. They go 5 laps, and there's a huge wreck, all right? And your dad is in the middle of this wreck, and he ends up hitting Bill Elliott, lifts up his car, and the whole front end of his car's messed up, right? Well, he comes on the radio, and he's like, my front end's this, my caster, my got 4 flat tires, my caster, my camber. I'm like, oh, this is all Greek to me, right? I got some water for you if you want.
3 inches.
So
thirsty.
He comes in, and I'm like panicking, right? And I know that he's got a 200-point lead. I'm looking for Rusty Wallace, and Rusty's running like 10th. He comes in, and not to get lapped, he comes in like 4 times, right, trying to beat and bang the car out. By the time they started the race again, he's right back to 39th, and Rusty's running like 9th, right? So as the race goes on, he's getting a little better. He's getting a little better, and he comes up to, you know, 35th and 32nd, and the race is coming. He comes up to 30th and 25th and gets up to 19th. And, you know, getting towards the 3/4 of the race, and you hear NASCAR come on the radio going, caution, caution, we got a smoker coming out of 4. And I'm looking, and all of a sudden, this car billowing smoke comes out of turn 4, and we all look, it's Rusty Wallace. He just blew up, right? So now, like, we're giddy, right? All these points that we thought we were losing, we got back, plus we're going to gain more points. So we're, like, excited, right? So your dad's out there busting his ass. They get down to 25 laps to go, and they bring him in and gets 2 tires. Goes back out and gets to the point where there's 10 laps left, and Ricky Rudd wrecks Jeff Gordon. When they come in, and, I mean, Jeff Gordon pushed up on him, Ricky gets behind him, and then squirrels, and boom, they both go in the wall, right? So there's 10 laps left. Andy Petrie comes on the radio, and Dale's running 4th. There are 9 cars on the lead lap. And Andy comes on and says, Dale, see if we can't get a jump. See if we can't finish 3rd. Your dad comes on the radio and goes, Andy, I want 4 new tires. He goes, no, you stay out there. You don't stay out there and see if you can get a jump. See if you can finish 3rd. He goes, no, I want 4 new tires. He goes, Dale, this is crazy, man. Just stay out there. By the time you go, there's going to be 4 laps left. Right, or 3 laps left, you're not going to be able to make up the time. There's 9 cars on the lead lap. You can conceivably come down to 9th place, see if you can get a jump and finish 3rd place. And Dale came on the way, goes, I didn't come here to finish 3rd. I'm at the entrance of pit road. And he goes, okay, come on in. We're going to put 4 tires on this car. We're going to sit back and watch you finish 8th. Your dad said, I tell you guys what, put 4 tires on this and you guys sit back and watch me win this race. Right? He pulls in. Like this. I'm trying to give a little water, right? And he won no part of that. He was glaring at Andy, right? Just glaring at him. Puts the 4 tires on, drops the jack, he takes off, right? They started up with 4 to go, and he's in 6th place. And he comes around, and he's in 5th, right? And he comes around, and he's in 4th. And they're running, and he's in 4th. And he comes around, and he's in 3rd. And he's starting to make some ground up on Morgan Shepherd when – the race ends. He finishes 3rd, right? So you get out of the car, he goes upstairs. Well, I could tell he kind of had the ass, right? But I thought it was cool. I thought he was doing great, right? So I did. I went back and I watched the replay this week of that race, and I watched his interview afterwards. And they got out. They said, Dale, why'd you come in with 4 to go? And he goes, well, he said, I knew 25 laps that I only took two tires. I knew I was dead in the water with those two tires. I wasn't going to do that. And I, you know, I felt like if we got some good tires on this car, I could win that race. The problem was I got long run tires instead of short run tires. Mm. If I had short run tires, I for sure would have caught Morgan Shepherd, and I might have had a chance of winning the race. But, you know, we ended up starting 38th. It was good. And at that point, they had a 330-point lead going into the last three races, right? So he goes upstairs to the condo. They pull the car back to start tearing apart. I'm going to go up and see Dale. So I go upstairs, and I'll never forget, I walked through the door of the condo, and Teresa, Taylor, and your grandmama was standing in the corner. And I should have known, you know, that he was pissed, right? Because he had his back on this table looking out at the racetrack he was eating. So I came over, and I put my arms around him from behind and put my head on his shoulder. And I said, man, that was awesome. That was a great race, right? He goes, great race. What was great about that? And I said, well, he goes, do you know what happened out there? He said, do you even understand what happened out there? And I said, no, I don't know. He goes, they wanted me to be mediocre. That's what happened. Yeah, we started 38th. Yeah, we got in a wreck. Yeah, Rusty blew up. I mean, everybody was satisfied with the points that we got. And they lost sight of the fact that we could have won that race. And he said they wanted me to be mediocre. And again, this was the only second time. He pulled me face to face and he said, Ned, you never, ever settle for mediocrity. Never in your life do you do it. You know why? Because you don't have to. That's why. Mm. And to that point, I got it on my arm. Never settle for mediocrity. Never. It's my thought. It's what I live by from that point on. And he was right. You know, I was guilty. I was so happy that he finished third, starting 38th. I didn't think about winning. I could care less if he won. He was gonna finish third. But he changed my mindset in things like that. And yeah, there's days we're going to be mediocre. But you don't settle for it. You work hard the next day so that you're not. And that was your dad. That was what he, you know, that's what he thought. And that's how he, you know, he lived his life. And it was crazy.
So when you say that he taught you to compete, this was the moments during that little run for that seventh championship where that was instilled.
No doubt. Yeah. No doubt. I learned so much about never giving up, staying focused, staying, being a leader on that team because he drug us along.
Yeah.
You know, if we slacked off a little bit mentally, he wouldn't have it. He pulled us along. He got us all back in line. And that was, you know, he taught me how to be a leader of a group of guys. Young players, what they want is discipline. They want organization and structure. And if you provide that for them, they're going to follow along with you. And it's the same thing your dad did. I mean, he made sure that you were going to be on the same page with him. And if you weren't on the same page with him, there were going to be a problem. But RCR and his group, 98% of the time, were on the same page with him. They never quit.
Staying focused, never giving up, staying hydrated. Am I right?
Oh, for sure.
That's right. You got to stay hydrated.
You got to stay hydrated.
Hydration engineer right there. I've never heard of another hydration engineer. Well, did your job.
I knew I did good. We were in Phoenix, and I knew that I hydrated him good because at the end of the race, he come boiling, I mean, into the hauler, right? Jumped out of the car, and I'm standing there. He's going like this, opened up the refrigerator, took out a half a gallon of milk, and started peeing in it. He's going, oh. He had nowhere to go. And he was about to wet his pants. But I'm thinking, okay, I did my job there.
That's hilarious.
Yeah. Oh, so that was cool.
If you like that conversation with Ned Yost, you ought to listen to the entire interview because the Dale Jr. Download is available on all major podcast platforms.